Kaimathias and Kobi Nissim. Okay. So before I start and talk about adversarial streaming, I want to start with the baseline of what non-adversarial streaming is. So I know you've all seen it in like undergrad or something, but still, let's go over it quickly. And the way I'll present what classical streaming is I'm going to present to you a sequence of pictures, and I want you to try and count the number of distinct pictures I show you. Okay? Are you ready? So let's start together. So the first picture, I have this witch or something. So that's one. Now comes this devil. So two. The witch again. So we are still at two. And now you continue alone. What did you get?
Eight.
So you're correct. I knew you could do it. But the question is, did you do it by memorizing the entire stream? Or did you have some kind of a sophisticated way? Me, at least, I just memorized the stream, right? But in streaming, the question is, what can we do when the stream is too long to memorize? OK. So there are many ways to define the streaming model. This is just one of them, but this is the way that I'm going to be thinking about today. So we have a stream of updates. Every update comes from some domain of size n. In this example, in the way I'm writing it here, I have the length of the stream is n, and I have some function that defines what I want to estimate. So I have some function g in the background that takes a prefix of a stream, returns a real number. And my goal is, on every time step, after I'm getting the next update in the stream, I want to output my current estimation for the value of the function g on the prefix of the stream that I've seen so far. And of course, I want to do it while using sublinear space. Okay, so this streaming model is super popular. It has many, many applications, but I'm sure you know all of them. So what I want to do now is I want to say exactly what I said now, but just again, and then I'll compare it to the model of adversarial streaming, which I will be thinking about today. So in the classical or oblivious model, we have our streaming algorithm, and we have some fixed but unknown stream of updates. So we don't know this entire stream, of course, but we assume that it is fixed in advance. And it is just given to us one update in a time. So on the first time step, I see the first update in the stream. I need to output my current estimation for the value of the function that I'm estimating. Then I get the next update in the stream. I output my modified estimation for the value of the function, and so on. Okay, so that's fine. What happens on the other side of the screen, on the adversarial setting? I still have my streaming algorithm, but now the stream is not fixed in advance. There is some adversary in the background that chooses the updates in the stream adaptively as time goes by. So on the first time step, this adversary chooses the first update in the stream, gives it to me. I process this update in the stream and output my first estimation for the value of the function. The adversary gets to see my estimation, and based on that, the adversary chooses the next update in the stream. I output the next estimation, and so on. So as you can guess, what's the challenge now? The challenge now is that the updates that the adversary choose for the stream, they depend on the previous answers that I gave out. And as a result, the updates in the stream can depend on my internal randomness. And that's a problem. Okay, so that's the formal definition of the adversarial streaming model that I'm thinking about today. So again, I have this function g in the background that I want to estimate. And now I'm thinking about a game between the adversary and the streaming algorithm. On every round, the adversary gives me the next update in the stream. His choice for that may depend on all of the history of the conversation. And I need to output my current estimation. And the adversary, his goal is to make me err on some point throughout the game. Okay, his goal is to make it such that at some point, my estimation would fail to be, let's say, accurate within some parameter alpha. Okay, so when you first see this problem for the first time, then you might say, okay, maybe I changed the game, but maybe nothing changed. Maybe, you know, classical existing streaming algorithms, they would still be good even in that model. And if your streaming algorithm is deterministic, then you would actually be correct and nothing changes and your algorithm would still continue to work. But random streaming algorithms, many of them would fail to be accurate in this adaptive model. And as it happens, we know that for many problems of interest, your streaming algorithm, if you want to do it with small space complexity, must probably be randomized. And then when you're using randomized streaming algorithm, you might run into this issue where as time goes by, the adversary learns information about your internal randomness, and then it's not accurate, but let's think about it as if the adversary learns all of my internal randomness, and then it's like informally, it forces me to be deterministic, and then I'm stuck with the deterministic impossibility results. So the informal takeaway from that slide is that we don't want the adversary to learn our internal randomness. Make sense? Okay. So let's see previous or related works that people have been doing on this question. So I think that like the first work that explicitly studied this model of adversarial streaming is this work in 2013 by Hart and Woodruff. And what they showed is negative results showing that if you're thinking about a linear streaming algorithm, then your algorithm is not going to do very well, generally speaking, in this adversarial model. And that's bad news because a lot of the existing streaming algorithms that we like are linear. So that negative results kind of rules out a lot of the existing classical algorithms. The next work that kind of did the large step forward by Eilon and Ben Eliezer and Jayaram and Woodruff. So they showed strong positive results. And what they showed roughly is a transformation that if you have a classical streaming algorithm, you can take it and transform it into a nonlinear streaming algorithm that would maintain accuracy even in the adversarial setting. And so this transformation incurs what's written in the end of this line here, small space overhead. And the question that you should ask me is, okay, what do you mean by small space overhead? And the answer is quantified using this definition that they call the flip number of the stream. So what is the flip number of the stream? The flip number of the stream is the maximal number of times that the value of the function can change, increase or decrease, by a multiplicative factor of 1 plus alpha, where alpha is my approximation parameter throughout the stream. So let's see an example. If what you're trying to do is count the number of distinct elements and say that there are no deletions in the stream, then the true number of distinct elements that's monotonically increasing, and then the number of times it can jump up by a multiplicative factor of 1 plus alpha is roughly one over alpha times log the length of the stream. Okay, and for many problems of interest, it turns out that the flip number of your problem is small. And when the flip number is small, then that's good because the transformation of Ben Eliezer et al. Incurs space blow up linear in the flip number lambda. Okay, so when lambda, the flip number is small, you should be happy. Okay, the next work by Woodruff and Zhu, they showed, so there are kind of other elements to this theorem, but informally, they showed a different transformation. saying that you can save a factor of alpha in the resulting memory blowup. So, right, if you look at the parameter lambda that's written here for the example of the distinct elements of counting the distinct elements, then lambda itself depends on 1/alpha. Then in the result of Woodruff and Zhu, you kind of save this additional blow up on the 1/alpha term. And that result was good because that got them to like tight bounds in this parameter alpha in the space for complexity that they got for many problems of interest. Make sense? Okay. So here is what we do. So like I said in the beginning, we kind of emphasize two connections between adversarial streaming and differential privacy. That connection we use to get positive results for adversarial streaming, and a connection to adaptive data analysis, which we use to get negative results for adversarial streaming. So what is differential privacy? Probably you all know it, but let's quickly mention it. Anyway, it's a mathematical definition for privacy that aims to allow statistical analysis of data sets while providing strong guarantees that individual information, that individual level information does not leak. So in this work, we don't care about data privacy, but like I'll show you next, we can use the definition of differential privacy as a tool in order to construct new adversarially robust streaming algorithms. And the negative result, that's via a connection to a recent line of work called adaptive data analysis. So what's the goal in this line of work? It's a line of work that tries to fight the problem of overfitting that occurs when empirical researchers collect data and then interact with it adaptively in order to derive their conclusions. But the fact that they are, you know, interacting with their data adaptively might lead to overfitting and false discoveries. So that line of work kind of tries to fight with this problem. So what we will show roughly is a reduction from some task in adaptive data analysis to the task of adversarial streaming. And after we have this reduction, roughly we can use negative results for the adaptive, from the adaptive data analysis literature to obtain negative results for adversarial streaming. Okay, so let's put on the screen the previous results that I showed you and the results that I'll be talking about today. So from differential privacy, the positive results, what we are getting is a different blow up in the space complexity. We only get something that looks like root lambda instead of linear in lambda. So strictly speaking, the results, like our result, is incomparable with the other results. So of course it's incomparable with that result, but it's also incomparable with the first result because we have this tilde here. But I'm not going to get into the specific bounds in this talk, so you wouldn't be able to compare them. And the negative result that we get, so let's first compare it with the result of Hart and Woodruff. So the negative result of Hart and Woodruff was very, very strong in terms of the bounds that they are getting. But it only holds for linear algorithms. So like before the last result that's written in red here, it was kind of possible that maybe, you know, everything you could do in the classical setting, you can also do in the adversarial setting, but maybe not using linear algorithms. So we show a specific example for a streaming problem for which no matter what you do, you're kind of stuck. And if you want to solve it in the adversarial setting, you must use a lot more memory than what you can, than the amount of memory that would suffice in the classical setting. Okay, great. Specifically, what we get is a problem that you can solve using polylogarithmic space complexity in the classical setting, but you must use polynomial space in the adversarial setting. And it turns out that the polynomial lower bound on the space that we get is exactly the up to this tilde, the square root of lambda. So if you compare what we have here and here, then you have both, in both results, we have this root lambda, okay? So I don't know if lambda is the correct measure to look at, but if you decided to use lambda as your, what controls your space overhead, then root lambda is what you have. Great. I told you what adversarial streaming is, showed you related works and a statement of our results. And now I want to say a few, a little bit about the connection to differential privacy and how we get positive results from it. So here's the formal definition of differential privacy. So differential privacy is a property of an algorithm that analyzes data. And the property states that the algorithm needs to be robust in the sense that if you were to modify one of its input elements in its input data, then the outcome distribution of the algorithm should not change by much. Okay? Specifically, this not change by much is quantified using these parameters of epsilon and delta, but you don't need to remember these parameters for my talk today. I wrote here initially an explanation and the interpretation for why do we think about this definition as a privacy definition, but in this talk, I don't care about data privacy, so I'm not going to say it, but if you want, I'll tell you later. So the idea is that we are going to use differential privacy in order to protect the internal randomness of our streaming algorithm. And when we do that, then we can show that this kind of limits the amount of information that the adversary gets to learn on our internal randomness. And then if, you know, ideally, if it learns nothing, then we should be happy because that kind of brings us back to the classical setting, right? Great, so the main takeaway here is that, you know, we use differential privacy only as a tool, not to protect the privacy of the data elements. We don't care about that. The adversary chooses the data elements. We cannot protect that from him, but we kind of use it in order to break dependencies between, with our input randomness. Okay, so here is an informal overview of the construction. So we take an oblivious streaming algorithm A for some problem. And so I'm thinking about, let's call this algorithm here, algorithm B. I'm thinking about this algorithm in my head as if its input is a collection of random strings. And then the first thing I do is I just instantiate, let's say K copies of my oblivious streaming algorithm A, where each copy I instantiate with the next input random string that I got. And now for M time steps, I obtain the next update in the stream. I feed it into each of the copies of A. Each of the copies of A brings me back an estimation for the value of the function. And I aggregate this, all of the collection of answers that I get from algorithm A using a differentially private algorithm that approximates the median. Okay, so I'm not showing you how do we construct a differentially private algorithm for the median, but it's like a super basic task and we have several differentially private algorithms for that. And the overview of the idea is let's try to think what happens if I were to modify only one of the RJs here. Let's say that I modify only R1 from my input collection of random strings. Then that would affect only the execution of the first copy of algorithm A, and therefore only like affects one of the intermediate estimations that I have. And that affects only one of the inputs to that private median algorithm, but the private median algorithm, its job is to hide any possible single difference in its input. So this algorithm private medians is hiding any single modification to an input random string. So that, if you formalize that, that would mean that algorithm B is differentially private with respect to the collection of random strings that we give it. And from that, you could show that basically it means that the adversary learns almost no information about my collection of random strings. And that would mean that on every time step, almost all of the copies of algorithm A, they give out accurate answers with respect to the function G, and therefore even my approx median would be accurate throughout the entire process. Make sense? So the question was, we know that there is a lower bound against general linear algorithms, and I'm claiming that this algorithm works, and in particular, it means that it cannot be linear, and therefore, what's not going to be linear is the private medium thing. You're right, I didn't think about it. I'll have to think about it some more to give you a, you're right, it's not going to be linear, it must not be linear, but I need to think about other implications. Right. I need to think about it. Okay. Okay. So that was very quick, but these ideas, you can formalize them, and it would show that some variant of the construction that I presented here results in an adversarially robust streaming algorithm with space blow up tilde square root of lambda. Okay. Great. So now I want to tell you about the connection to adaptive data analysis and how do we get negative results from that. And before I'll show you the negative results that we get from it, I want to quickly remind you what adaptive data analysis is all about. Okay, so before I'll show you the problem of adaptive data analysis, let's do a quick warm up. So here is a problem that we all know. I have some fixed but unknown distribution D over some domain X, and I have a fixed function H mapping the domain X to either 0 or 1, and I have some accuracy parameter alpha. My input is a database S containing N IID samples from this unknown distribution D, and what I want to do is estimate the expected value of this function H over the unknown distribution D. Let's say up to this parameter error parameter alpha. And the question is, what should I do? Okay, so of course we all know the answer. You just compute the empirical average, and by the Hofding bound, that's going to be a very good estimation for the expected value of the function. Okay, so that's easy. Nothing interesting here. And here is a little tweak, still not interesting to that warm up question. So the question is exactly the same, but instead of only one function, I have K functions fixed in advance. I know them. And now I want to take a sample S containing N IID elements from the underlying distribution and estimate the average of each of these given functions. What do I do? Exactly the same. Compute the empirical average of each of these functions over my input sample, and again by the Hofding bound, maybe with the union bound, you get that all of your answers are still accurate. Okay, but an important thing we used here, and also in the first warm-up, is that all of these K functions, they were fixed in advance. What's important is that they are independent of the sample S that I got. Otherwise, Hofding would not work. Okay, and so that's warm-up number two, and here is the basic problem in the adaptive data analysis literature. I still have the underlying distribution D. I don't know it, but it's fixed. I still get a sample S containing N IID samples from the underlying distribution. And now what's changed is that the functions are not fixed in advance. Now, for K rounds, on every round, I get the next function, and I need to respond with an estimation for the expected value of that function. After I announce my estimation, I get the next function, and so on. And as you can guess, the difficulty is that the choice of these functions may depend on my previous answers, and therefore may depend on my sample. I'm going to say exactly the same, but with a picture, okay? I have the underlying distribution here with all of these people. I have my mechanism and I have a data analyst. In the beginning of the game, I get a sample containing n IID elements from the distribution, and that's the end of the distribution, the end of the interaction I have with the distribution. Now, on every time step, the data analyst fixes some predicate, gives it to me. I need to respond with an estimation for the expected value of that predicate over the unknown distribution. The analyst gets this estimation, then decides on the next function. I respond, and so on. And as you can guess, the goal is our job is to construct a mechanism that guarantees that all of its answers would be accurate with respect to the empirical average. And the question is, what is the size of the sample that I need to obtain at the beginning of the game such that I would be able to support K adaptive queries with accuracy alpha? That's the main formulation of the problem in the adaptive data analysis literature. And if you are seeing this question for the first time, then again, you might say, okay, maybe nothing changed. You know, maybe I can just answer with the exact empirical average in the warmups, in the non-adaptive warmups that worked fantastically. Then maybe I can still do that. And if you think about it for a little while, you will see that the answer is no. If you do that, if you respond with the exact empirical average, you could fail already in step number two. Okay, so in step number one, you're not going to fail because H1 is in fact independent of your sample. But if you respond with the exact empirical average, even your second response may be completely inaccurate. Okay, so the exact empirical average, that doesn't work, but there are other things we can do. And here is like a summary of the existing upper and lower bounds for what we know how and don't know how to what to do about this problem of adaptive data analysis. So first, if you care about constructing efficient mechanisms that answer queries, then we know basically that if you wanna answer K adaptively chosen queries, then we have almost matching upper and lower bounds saying the sample size that you need is root K. If you want efficient mechanisms, you can do it with root K, and you must use root K examples. But if you are okay with inefficient mechanisms, then suddenly you can answer much, much more queries. The number of queries you can answer can be exponential in the sample size n. Okay? The trivial algorithm would be right. Divide the input sample into chunks and use every chunk only once, and that would be linear in K. So these upper bounds are not trivial, right? Okay, so the upper bound really works by computing the empirical average and adding noise, and that gets you to root K, but the proof is challenging. And the intuition for why we can do better than that then is that you're not going to add independent noise to each of the queries. You're going to do something much more sophisticated, that when you answer the next query, it depends on all of the history, and you can do it, but it's computationally costly. Okay? Yes, it assumes one-way functions. Move on. Okay, So now we know what adaptive data analysis is. Let's see how do we use it in order to get negative results for adversarial streaming. And like I think I mentioned already, the idea is to show a reduction from the simple ADA problem that we just saw into a reduction to the problem of adversarial streaming. And specifically, I'm going to show a reduction to a specific problem such that if you can solve that problem in the adversarial streaming model, then you can solve the basic ADA problem that we showed before, but then you run into the impossibility results that we mentioned, and therefore you could not solve the problem that I'll show you now in the adversarial streaming model. And the problem that we define, we call it the streaming adaptive data analysis problem or the SADA problem. Okay, so on every time step, your update is one of two types. Either your ith update is a data point from a domain X, or your ith update is a function mapping the domain X to either 0 or 1. And your goal is on every time step I, you want to estimate the average of the last function that you got as input over the multiset containing all of the data points you got as input. Okay, so I think you got it already, but here is formally or more formally the definition of this SADA problem. So let's look at some time step I. I have this UI vector, that's the prefix of the stream that I got so far. Somewhere in this prefix of the stream, I got both functions and data points. I ignore all of the functions that I got except for the last function that I got as an update. That's this F here. And I denote by S the collection or the multiset of all of the data points that I got till now in the stream. And my goal is to approximate the average of this function F over the multiset S. Make sense? So great, so we understand what the SADA problem is, and now intuitively, why should that be a good problem to look at? So first, let's agree that in the classical setting, in the oblivious setting, I can solve this problem using small space complexity, and the reason is that I have sampling. I don't need to remember the potentially many, many, many input data points that I got in the stream. I just can maintain a representative sample of all of the input points that I got in the stream. And then when you give me a function, I can evaluate, I can estimate its empirical average over the entire stream just by looking at its empirical average over the sample that I am maintaining. Okay, so that's easy. And the intuition is, why should that not work in the adversarial setting? Because in the adversarial setting, we don't have this trick of sampling, right? We know that in the adversarial setting, if you want to support many, many adaptively given functions, your input sample must be large. Your input sample must be large. Your memory is large. You're not doing very well. Make sense? If you want to answer, I don't know, k queries, your sample must be of size root k, that's polynomial, you have large space complexity. Yeah.
So my question is why do we look at this specific problem? So why couldn't we say that the stream consists first of all the data points and then of the function?
Right.
This seems like a harder question, whereas the first one gives great
Right. I can also present it like that. Right, so the question is, why do I allow, you know, the data points to be everywhere and not just say, okay, the first such and such updates are the data points and then all of the updates. So we can do it like that. I think that even in the paper, maybe we wrote it, we have several variants. One of them I think is just like that. We can do it like that. Okay, other questions? Okay. So here is like an overview of the reduction from the ADA problem, the adaptive data analysis problem, to solving this SADA problem in the adversarial streaming model. Okay, so I want to solve the ADA problem. I'm constructing an algorithm B whose input is a sample S containing n IID elements from some underlying unknown distribution. And the first thing that I do, so I have in my hands the algorithm A, which is an adversarially robust streaming algorithm for the SADA problem. And the first thing I do, I just feed all of the elements in my input set S to this streaming algorithm A one by one. These are like the first N input N updates in the stream for algorithm A. Okay, I did that. And now I need to answer K adaptively chosen queries. So on every round for I from one till K, I obtain the next query Fi. I feed this query Fi to algorithm A. Algorithm A needs to respond with some answer Zi. I just output Zi, that's my response also. That's the algorithm, okay. So here is the idea for the analysis. So let's fix some distribution D over our domain, and let's think about running algorithm B over a sample, I call the sample P here, over a sample P containing IID elements from D. And now, by construction, if algorithm A is accurate, its job is on every time step to give me an accurate response with respect to the empirical average of every given function onto the given input sample P. So that's good, but that's not what we wanted, right? The difficulty in the ADA problem is not to maintain accuracy with respect to the empirical sample. That I can do, I can answer infinitely many queries like that, right? The difficulty is to maintain accuracy with respect to the unknown population. And so I have this gap here, and we bridge this gap using compression arguments. So these are arguments from learning theory, saying that all of algorithm B here basically have small space complexity, and algorithms with small space complexity, they generalize. So by the fact that this algorithm has small space complexity, we use arguments from learning theory to show that empirical accuracy must be close to accuracy with respect to the unknown population, and that fixes this problem. Right, so these ideas can be formulated to show that the algorithm works. But another issue that I want to put my finger on here is that if you remember the strong lower bounds for the adaptive data analysis problem, they assumed one-way functions, right? They were computational. And even more than that, we know that if you don't care about runtime, you can answer basically as many queries as you want in the ADA problem. To get these negative results, we need the strong polynomial lower bounds on the adaptive data analysis problem. What this means is that, as I stated it, we just get a computational lower bound, but that's not what we are aiming for. And so in the paper, we replace, so the reason that these negative results for the ADA problem assume one-way function is that they use some efficient encryption scheme. We open the construction, replace this encryption scheme with an encryption scheme that is secure against adversaries with bounded memory. In this story, the adversary is actually the algorithm A, which has bounded memory, and everything goes through. Okay, I'm out of time. Summary, we use differential privacy to get positive results for adversarial streaming, blow up roughly root lambda. We use negative results from the adaptive data analysis literature to get negative results, again, a gap of root lambda. So like I mentioned, the open questions, I think, is first, what is lambda the correct parameter to look at? Should we look at other, you know, necessary or sufficient conditions for when I have an adversarially robust streaming algorithms and when I don't? Another open question. So the SADA problem, as I said it, maybe it sounds kind of semi-natural, but when you plug in the tools from the crypto bounded storage model, then that kind of makes it more unnatural. So an open question that I would like to see a negative result for a really natural problems, specifically, let's say, for the king of problems, estimating the second moment of the stream. Okay, that's completely open. And Finally, I'll do a quick promo. We are doing a workshop in Stoke, in the upcoming Stoke, about this subject. So virtually come, okay? Yeah. So the question is if I can give a little more details about how the analysis works for the positive results, for the positive result. So I can, I hope it will be clear. So you agreed with me that this algorithm is differentially private with respect to the collection of input random stream. And the key property we need is that differential privacy, so it's two properties. First property, it's easy. Differential privacy is closed under post-processing, right? So that's fine. What it means is that, like we said, all of the answers that I give out, they are the result of a differentially private computation on the collection R. The analyst or adversary, whoever generates the queries, how does he do it? He post-processes my answers and gives me the next function. So all of the functions, by closure to post-processing, they are the result of a differentially private computation over the collection of random strings out. And like in learning theory, we said compression arguments imply generalization, then also differential privacy implied generalization in the sense that if you have a differentially private computed function, that function generalizes. Its empirical average is going to be very close to its true average. And therefore, all of the functions I have throughout this process, empirical average and true average are similar, but so that's basically the idea. I'm still hiding some of the details, but if that satisfies you, then